So just to have everything go on the recording as well, thank you for welcoming me, and that is a thank you on behalf of Alan Hanbury, on behalf of the Research Studios Austria, who are managing the this project, the Data Market Austria, as well as on behalf of the TU Wien, who will be organizing this continued education course that I'm going to talk about in the second half of the presentation. At the beginning, it's about Data Market Austria. So let's see what that is. And this is what it is. Well, as the name would indicate, it is a light project developing the infrastructure and the protocols and the standards to be able to share data in Austria between anybody. Not only open data, but also commercial data, between service providers who develop small components, algorithms, between data providers who make this data available either for a cost or for free, between data market customers. I have an example, and it'll be a bit clear what the difference is between all of these groups, between end users. The objective, we have three objectives in this project. One is to advance technology foundations. Part of this project are research societies, research, we call them corporations, Gesellschaften, Forschungsgesellschaften. So one of the objectives is to advance the technology foundations in order to make all of this possible. The other one is to interconnect clouds. We have, even if Austria is a relatively small country, we have a number of different providers, multinational providers, and it's now difficult to switch from one to the other if you're running on one of the clouds. And third, in addition to all this technology, right, in addition to the services, in addition to the research, in addition to the infrastructure interconnection, we suspect that there might be new business models that will be created as a result of this interconnection. And the question is, what kind of business models will be created? How can we encourage such business models to be created? So this innovation environment that should be present there. Now, this is all very nice. We have these objectives, and this is all cool. How are we going to do this? Well, we start concretely by having some pilots. So part of the project, we have two pilots, a mobility and an Earth observation pilot, where companies, our members already of the project, are working directly with the infrastructure providers, are working with us and with their existing partners in order to create these kind of applications. So one is talking about, for instance, in the mobility pilot, I have an example about taxi fleets. The Earth observation pilot is about, for instance, one of the use cases is to observe forest damage after incidents and to automatically detect and notify if this happens. And of course, as part of the project itself, so as part of these 3 years, we will make first steps to further domains. This is why I'm here, to sort of already, even if we don't have a data market yet, there's nothing that I can say, okay, go now and you can already log in and buy stuff or sell stuff. I'm here to promote it and to get feedback from you and to make sure that by the end of this project, it is easy for everybody to be a part of this data market. So who are we right now? These are the three components I said earlier, the connected clouds, the data innovation environment, the technology foundations, plus the pilots. We have 17 partners in the... So each component has obviously more partners. That's a risk management issue. On the technology foundations, you would see the Forschungsgesellschaften, the RSA, that's the Research Studios Austria, the AIT and the KNOW Center, who are particularly involved in research. On the pilots, we have T-Mobile, Bouncing Bytes, Wikimedia, the Zentrale Amt für Meteorologie und Geologie, and the EODC. Let's take an example. It's easier for me to explain. The mobility pilot example, the taxi fleet management. So the idea here is that we already have a customer, part of this consortium that's Bouncing Bytes. So they take the example, this role of a data market customer. They have an application that they're already providing to their end users who are taxi companies. And this application helps these taxi companies manage their fleets, right? So where should drivers be? Now the problem is, so you see that these are the end users, the green box there. The problem is, according to the data market customer, this application is not very smart. It's smart to some extent. It's, of course, the best there is. But it could be smarter. So how do we make it smarter? Well, they would like to use some other services that they don't necessarily want to develop in-house. For instance, a heat map over the city, such that they would know where to send their taxis at different time, at any time of day or night. So you might have a service provider who generates such heat maps for data in general. Right? This is not a brand new technology, heat maps. So this should be available on the data market. This should be running, obviously, on the infrastructure providers, so it should be easily accessible. You don't have to buy it and install it on your own machine. It's just there. And it uses data from a variety of data providers. And this is where the interconnection really plays a role, because we want to, okay, we can create heat maps. There are plenty of algorithms to do that. And I'm sure we can easily put together in Python, for instance, a little plot.
Of course.
To do that. But we need the data. So this is where the essential component comes in, and the ability to make data available, to get money for your data, because not everything is for free, and it doesn't need to be, and generate new services. Now, the data market customer, of course, needs to do some sort of cleverness on top of this heat map, because you don't want to send all your taxis to the red area. You still need to distribute it to apply this heat map service. So you have to have this little connection being still built by the data market customer. This is, to some extent, important, because this is what creates a competitive advantage for this particular enterprise. Because this being a data market, another taxi management application company could come in and also use a service, because the service is available to be bought or sold on the data market. So we still need to have some differences between those two companies. Now, in this previous slide, I had all of these components that you have seen earlier on the map of the data market. So all of them are here, the end users, data market customers, providers, infrastructure providers, and service providers. What was missing there were these two components, the research and development component and the broker component. Well, the research and development component, it's not hard for me to explain. Hello. It's the universities, the research studios. What is a bit more difficult, perhaps, are the brokers. Well, the problem is, and this is a significant problem, so actually the brokers play a vital role in the data market, that you might have data there, but you either you don't know it's there, or you don't know how to use it, we don't know which services go with which data, and what is the output of those services, because they will generate new data. So the brokers are there in order to facilitate this matching between between data and services. So if you ask me what exactly are these brokers, again, it's something that we are studying. Right now, we can see two options. One is you actually have humans who offer these services as consultants. And the other one is we have systems. We are one of the work packages in there is to create recommender systems for data. So you have a representation of the data and you match it with the services. Where are we? We are very much at the beginning of this project. It started officially in October 2016. We had our kickoff meeting. I know that some of you were there in November. last year. And what we are doing now is essentially we're doing this integration planning. How do we get stuff running on, for instance, the T-Systems infrastructure, that stuff that is running also on the high-performance computing used by the TIMG, for instance. All of these things have to come together, and it's obviously not easy bringing together different people with different requirements and different expertise and experiences. And also what we are doing right now, we're doing community consultation, so why I'm here. We're also doing workshops. I know that on Monday we have one in Linz, and we try to organize it all over Austria that we get feedback. And in fact, at the end of these slides, I have, instead of letting you ask me questions, I have questions for you that I hope you will answer. So, community feedback. Now, for the data science community in particular, what is this data market useful for? In case it's not obvious. And well, some cases, some things are not necessarily obvious. One thing that we plan to release quite soon are sandboxes. So this should happen definitely by the end of the year. And I'll actually, on the next slide, I say why this should happen by the end of the year, but hopefully sooner, where you can say, OK, I need a sandbox. I want to try something on that infrastructure, have some access to some demo data, play around with it, see what comes out. In the end, the objective is to have transparent pricing, that data is available and you know how much it's going to cost, and that you also know how much you're going to get for the services you're providing or for the data that you'll be providing. Of course, part of this brokerage element will come into a search engine for data and services. It should be easy to publish the data and services you create. And there should be smart contracts. And we have a lot of discussions what the smartness in there is. The idea of the smart contracts, at least as far as I understand it now, and this may change based on, as I learn, is that the contracts know when they are being fulfilled. So when you start acquiring data, this is, it's not, because then the question would be, what is the difference between a smart contract and the contract that you sign and you pay something and you get something back, which is what you would normally get. The idea of the smart contract is that you pay something, you are committed to get some data, for instance, or a service, and this is monitored and it is locked in blockchain so that you don't, there's no possibility of cheating on the contract. So if all of this sounds interesting, you can, of course, participate, and we hope that in the end you will participate. Right now, what you can do is simply register to the newsletter. As I said, right now there is no infrastructure that I can promise you to have access this evening or tomorrow morning. I'm going to stay up late, but not that late. But as I said, we will definitely have the sandboxing available by the end of the year. The reason we're going to have that is because we already have an agreement to have a call for startups to receive financing from the data market to build services and build applications on top of this by the end of the year. So there will be a call issued in fall to essentially finance small projects done by you on top of this data market. And it's up to you what you want to do with that. It's a competitive call, of course, but the proposal is completely open. More short term, there is a public meetup. A public meeting. It's not a meetup in the sense of meetup. It's a meeting. In Salzburg on the 6th of April in the evening, so I hope you will join us there as well. And that's it, the part about data market. I have these questions for you, and I'm not going to stop to get your answers now. I'm just going to read them out because I have something else to talk about before you think about it for a second. So what are your requirements for a data market? What would you like to be able to do there? Do you see advantages of it? Of course you do. What are they, let's say? What would be the disadvantages? What would discourage you from participating? What would be your concerns about it? And any other comments you might have? But again, don't all rush to answer now. Okay, there's a link. Because I still have to talk about the continued education course. And I'm gonna come back to these questions in the end, so you will still have them on the screen. So at the TU Wien, we are planning a data science and deep learning continued education course. We're hoping to get financing for this. And it should have these six components. Each module is 60 hours, six modules, 30 hours of theory and 30 hours of exercises. And this is targeted primarily towards companies. So if you are a company, you should be able to participate. It doesn't cost anything to participate if we get the financing. And also if we get the financing, the companies participating will get financing as well for the time that their employees spend at these courses. So these are fundamentals of data science, then three modules in parallel, advanced data science, deep learning, and text analysis and word embeddings. And then from data to stories, and finally, fundamentals of the data market participation, where essentially all of the things that we would have learned in the process will be applied on the data market. So we're trying to make sure that really we cover every possible aspect of both the data market and of the education component of these modules. I have six slides, one like this for each of these modules. I wouldn't go through them and read them because I will make the slides available anyway for the meetup. You get the idea. If I talk about fundamentals of data science, it means a lot of maths, statistics, data processing. If I talk about advanced data science, then we would talk about scalability issues. We would talk about stream analysis, particular types of data that you would encounter during in your company, for instance. Deep learning is essentially neural networks with the new technologies that are now available, with the new models that are available. Text analysis, which traditionally worked very well on image processing. We had a project that finished some time ago where we annotated images, and these were very generic images, Flickr kind of images, and that we realized it works at a level that is human by all means. So humans, when you ask them to annotate stuff, they would generally agree on an easy task at about 80%, so because humans are different. Machines now agree with humans for that particular task of annotating images also about 80%. So essentially, for that simple task of saying what's in this picture, that picture being cats and dogs and, you know, Flickr stuff, we have very good models. In terms of text, it didn't really work that well. And in fact, for search technology, for instance, we are now trying to make this work. It's not immediately obvious. It has worked, and there's a very good experience in natural language processing, in parsing sentences, in doing inference directly from free text, which is really cool stuff, by the way. Essentially, you have sentences, and without any additional knowledge, you can detect whether the two sentences, the two statements, are in agreement or in conflict with each other. Rather cool stuff. And then from data to stories, interpreting data, visualization, communicating data, the results of your data analysis. And as I said, in the end, we cannot have a course on data science without teaching our participants on how to use the data market, how to provide their services on the data market. And I'm sure that by that time, we will know exactly what the smart contracts are and how to implement them. So, as I said, this is the overview. Here are also some questions for feedback. What is missing from what you have? But I'll come back to the questions.
You're still missing some graph stuff. Because currently you're switching to the paradigm of every physical
Yes. That's a very good point. And I know that we're switching to graph. I mean, the knowledge graph has been around for some time now. Actually having methods that use it efficiently is the interesting part. I agree. I'm going to come back to this. So what is missing? What is not needed? What should be done in another way? What could be the added value of this offering? So by the way, I just got the slides at 5 p.m. today. So I apologize for reading a bit the long questions. So I will come back to this feedback and to the feedback for the data market after I plug another summer school that we are organizing at the TU Wien on the 21st, 25th of August. Keyword search in big link data. It's not my title, but it is the one we're organizing. So if that sounds also interesting, that is also for free. It doesn't have any cost of participating, and I'm sure there will be cookies. If you are interested in general in the course, in the continued education courses, please contact either Alan or myself. And with that, I would come back to these two sets of feedback. So this is these are the questions that I had on the first half of the presentation, and these are the questions that I had for the second half of the presentation. So what I'm hoping is to get feedback from you and to start a discussion about the data market. As far as you understood from what I had so far, which I would argue is not a lot because it's at the beginning of the project, what would be your requirements for a data market? Would you see yourselves as a data provider? Or more a service provider. So let me ask you this. Who here would say that they would be a data provider? I don't expect a lot of hands. One, two, three, four. Okay, good. So at least we have some samples. Who here would be more of a service provider, writing service applications? I suspect everybody here programs, right? So everybody, I'm just gonna raise your hands by default. Okay. So from this perspective of a data provider or as a service provider, what would be some requirements that you would have from the data market?
Slightly different question, or maybe yes. Differently worded, but what about exclusivity in within the data market? If I say for basically the same thing that happens in patent law, or I have some trademark and I'm allowed to use that within this specific field and no one else is allowed to use it there. So if I say I want to take this data and use it in this specific field, is it planned or intended or not at all, or the opposite of being able to use it exclusively and within a specific field?
So the question is how is intellectual property going to be managed?
Basically, yes. Thank you for rewording that.
Indeed, there are, well, I see only one case where the intellectual your question actually is where it might be interpreted as not necessarily intellectual property. For instance, if I generate new data and I'm explicitly not allowing certain people to use it because they are my competitors. So can that be done? It's on the to-do list now. This is recorded, right? So
yes, it is.
Perfect. Then we can come back.
But yes. It's not just data. Sometimes brokers, what they don't, is basically creating a model with data that is already there. And maybe that isn't the company that he's talking about. Because creating a model, data is just data, it's not information. Mm-hmm. A model converts this data to information that drives decision making. That's his intellectual property.
Right. The reason I escaped the question of intellectual property was because there are laws for that. Indeed, there's infrastructure, and infrastructure in the sense of legal infrastructure for managing intellectual property. We, as the data market Austria, we can take input and maybe not advertise it, but raise these issues. But the legal part has to be done by the other partners in society. In general, intellectual property will continue to be protected, of course, by copyright and by patents. Well, patents are an issue, particularly in software in Europe. But that's it. Copyright is the primary element here, I would say.
It would be maybe good to know, from the point of view of service providers, what exactly what kind of services will be in demand by data consumers?
The question is, and I'm repeating the question just to make sure that it's also heard on the tape. The question is, from the point of view of service providers, what kind of services would be requested by customers? Or did I get that correctly?
Yes.
What would be sort of the things that would be needed? I have no idea. In the sense that I cannot tell right now what would be, certainly what will definitely be available and will be needed are basic services, a clustering algorithm, all the clustering algorithms, heat maps, stuff like that. And you can do it, and if you do it better, if it's more efficient, then yours will be used more than others. You build on top of that, and what you build on top of that, indeed, it's a market, but you have to identify the customers yourself as a service provider. So I don't think I have a question, an answer for that, especially not at this time.
Yes. I would say that what I encounter very often that it's very hard to get actually some certain very simple data. For example, you had listed the Zentralanstalt für Meteorologie and blah blah blah. If I want to get the temperature of the last 5 years for Vienna on a daily basis, it's very hard to do. I need to contact someone by phone or something like that. And it gets even worse if you talk to people from Statistic Austria, if you catch them between their breaks, lunch breaks, and afternoon coffee breaks. So some of the basic data is really hard to get. And I would expect from such a data market that the very basic set of data, like number of companies by an ACE industry code, would be available in such a market. Because that's something that everybody needs.
Yeah. Yeah. So I fully agree. It is difficult now to get this data, especially because you have to contact people, and people are unreliable in general. It's better if you do it automatically. And this is the objective.
Let me give an answer to the better data. So the better company, like, is an IBM company, but they offer such better data for the whole world. And it depends on the amount. So you pay for whatever, like Google Maps. So feel free to use the API. It's quite simple. Better data
is covered. Okay, cool.
So there are providers, indeed.
Yes.
It would be easier if...
But we should talk how we could integrate into the data market.
Yeah.
Exactly. Ah, so we really have a data provider then. By the end of this year, what we will have is to integrate the existing open data sources, because then it's easier. When you integrate commercial data, we have this issue of payments and contracts that are probably not going to be done by the end of this year. But open data should be there.
Let me maybe rephrase that. Have you thought about adding like a wish list of data so that people can like user voice vote up what they want to have as data and then say maybe that could be a task for the broker. That
exactly.
The broker looks at what are frequently requested data sets and then the broker in turn could like talk to those people who actually have the data.
That's a very good point.
So
I will definitely look at the video again to write this down. Having the broker, part of the tasks of the broker, not just to match existing data, but identify what data needs are there and to bring them into the market. Yeah. That's a very good point.
I wanted to ask if there will be some certification of the data quality, for example, or
Yes.
Yes,
so there is but there is a one work package that handles this. There is also another research project that is now running. One of our partners, the Donald Investigative Claims, is also there, adequate, and it does exactly this. It's trying to identify parameters and standards on how you could quantify the quality of the data and make sure that whatever kind of label you give it, it's understood by others. It's agreed upon that this is what it means, and this is the difficult part. And we will be adopting that standard, yes. So it is, but as you are aware, because you're asking the question, it's kind of tough because it's not clear what it means. Exactly, but we have data, we have both data quality and service quality work tasks.
Have you been thinking about the source? I don't know if you already mentioned it. We have, in my opinion, a big source of data and knowledge and whatever at the universities worldwide. This is one source. Another source is existing data in the web,
right.
Social media, and so on. If you were speaking about time temperatures, at least, or whatever, GDP, or I don't know, whatever data, they are on the web, at least for some periods, for free.
Exactly, for some periods.
Somebody,
one of the things that we will...
The first point would be, in my opinion, this is a really big source of data and knowledge, the young people, and the young people of Europe. And I studied at the Mihai Institute for Advanced Studies, and last Sunday there was a Pressestunde with director and of this institute, and he told there or mentioned there that we as Europe, we are very dependent on America and so on. And in my opinion, this is another question.
Okay.
How we will and where we are going and what we are going to do about it. These 3 points, students, web, and...
universities. So the point was that there is a lot of data generated by universities, there's a lot of data online, and how do we get the know-how of the young generation into the market, let's say?
Not be too dependent. If I'm speaking about Python, it's probably you are better, but it was developed probably in the US. It's now open source and so on. It's developed worldwide, but still we are dependent.
Okay. I have no comment on the second part. On the first part, on the data that is available online, the Data Market Austria does not plan on collecting its own data. We expect that the data providers will be collecting data and want to do that in order to get money, or because they are an open data society and they want to share open data. Regarding the data that is generated by universities, there have been a number of international projects. The biggest one that I'm aware of is the so-called Research Data Alliance. There are many issues there that have to do with versioning of the data that are being handled there, with IDs for data. So indeed, all of that is there, and it's on our research agenda in general. Again, from the perspective of research of the Data Market Austria, we would expect that participants in the data market provide the data, and our task is to make this provisioning easy for them, but not to collect the data ourselves, not to crawl the web. First and then it's going to be...
Okay. Regarding data quality, I think a challenge is that if you are a data provider, you might have a different understanding of data quality than if you are, a service provider. Because if you are a data provider and you are not in the position of offering a service, for example, and you say, okay, this data is not so important for me, such that I can give it away. An indicator of having good data might be, okay, all my sensors were online the last year, so just this is my data. But when you want to use it, we have usually very different requirements, and because you want to use this data, you really have to dig into it, and then you see, oh my god, it's it's just a huge mess. So usually it looks like this.
Yes.
And then you have to ask your provider, oh yeah, but there is this issue, and there is this issue, and yeah, we have seen some irregularities, and all of a sudden this becomes a lot of work. So if you are, putting some data online and then working with it, and then maybe feedbacking, and for example, fixing a system, this is something very different. And I think, so I think this is a challenge.
Absolutely, it is a challenge, and I'm repeating now, to make sure that the data provider has the same concept of quality as the data service, as the service provider that will be using that data. And I would say, yes, we are aware of that, and it's not just that. It's also that two different service providers will have different concepts of quality because they are doing different things with the data, and one needs it to be very reliable in time, for instance, that it has to happen every second, the data point. The other one might need it to be very reliable in the value it gets in the sensor value that it, in the reading that it gets. Maybe it doesn't need to be every second, but it needs the value to be precise. So that is part of the metadata description that will be generated in the project. You had a question?
Yeah, I just had a comment so it's not the job of the data market to collect the data from the web or whatever, but this would be a good business model for participants in the data market probably. To crawl the data, to go to libraries, getting data, and so on.
Absolutely. It would be an excellent business model as a service to collect data and sell it, cleaned a bit, on the data market.
What is actually the long-term perspective? I understand the project is now running for 3 years, so we develop some services, the data providers, I've seen some big names, T-Mobile also, I assume, simply now just extend the services that's what's already there and provided. And if you're not a small player entering it, okay, you put some effort into it, but what's after those 3 years? Is there a plan of an organization? Will this be handled by universities, or is it just stopped afterwards and left out into the wild?
No, not at all. Though I realize where that question is coming from, the question being what will happen when the project is over. There is a Verein that will be established, and I think it's already underway to be established to make sure that we continue this. Essentially, this has to be self-sustaining. This is very important for all the actors, and especially the ones providing the financing, with the BNP. So they want to make sure as well that this is not a typical research project that will, the moment the financing ends, disappear from the. And we, none of us want that.
One of the requirements that I would see for Data Market Austria would be to get some open data from institutions like Statistic Austria was mentioned before, where useful data sets there, and they already provide in a different form where you can download it to an Excel. But in terms of a data marketplace, there are today far more better ways to serve that data. And then also institutions like Austria, Österreich. I would expect, or I would rather require for data in Austria to have data that is relevant to Austrian businesses. Yeah? So regardless of startup or not startup, but relevant to Austrian businesses in terms of the economic development, maybe some environmental and other influences, maybe also across the borders in the whole of Europe, with partnerships with other markets.
So the requirement that I've heard is to have, first of all, as a first step, the data is already available from the Wirtschaftskammer, from other sources, particularly that data that is relevant for Austrian businesses in Austria. And that is exactly our plan for the first year, to get this data. This data that should be already available to make it easy. And this would be for us a testing to see that these contracts work, that the infrastructure works, that we can indeed log in and just use some data that is already there.
And that's also something that is needed to get this market
running.
Growing,
yeah, exactly.
In terms of also further data providers.
Exactly. We need something to start, and we cannot, nobody would sell data if there are no services, and nobody would put in the services if there's no
system.
So the open data is the solution for the first time.
I mean, and there are also other platforms like one for financial data, and they also have a variety of data sets. So I would need to see something specific to with an Austrian and Europe focus.
Okay. Thank you.
I actually have a follow-up question regarding this business idea of cleaning up data and providing it to the data market Austria, because having this data available as open data seems to me as a very important pillar of this project. I am absolutely no expert in that, but is that actually compatible with, for example, the most common licenses? Like, for example, cleaning up data from Wikipedia, whatever I do,
mm-hmm.
and then providing it to the data market in a commercial manner? Generally possible?
It depends on the license on which the data was initially released.
Of course.
There are licenses.
I don't know.
I don't know what the most common ones are. I don't.
Okay.
I cannot answer that. But there are licenses which would allow you to do that,
okay.
And there are licenses which would not allow you.
Okay.
To do
that. That might be one of the requirements actually for the data market. Would need to provide that kind of advice.
Yes.
You know, I mean, this is, you know, if a person wants to start providing data or whatever, to provide that legal advice.
It is, and in fact, just yesterday I was looking at our draft for the metadata description for data set, and the licensing information is part of the metadata that we would be asking to make sure we have for each data item.
Downside, there's a recent news for security breaches, CIA leaks, and so on. Do you have also any work packages about security, how to deal in all the data set that comes together in the data market? How do you secure it? And how to make sure that all the people who pay for it or are allowed to read it get it. Is there a framework plan or how is this handled?
Of course, there is a work package. So the question of security, how do we make sure that people who pay for it have access and nobody else has access to the data? That is part of the infrastructure work package. There is a task in there. It gets easily very complicated because you have layers of security and you have layers in the data. And it's exactly. So you cross those two sets and you try to figure out how who has access to what. Yes. It's a big issue.
You think about it, but
yes.
How will the whole infrastructure and interfaces be built? Will it be that you have to do everything in the data market, like the data, you have to send your data there, and then the algorithms run on your data and on the external data? Or is there also a possibility to fetch the data into your local cluster and then do some analysis with your data that you don't want to give into the cloud, or you have a customer that doesn't want to see this data in this data market cloud?
There are, so how is it, again, I'm repeating just for the sake of recording, how is this going to work? Will we be forced to work only on the data market, or can we download and work on our own cloud? If I have additional data that I want to combine but I don't want to make available, how is that going to work? First, an easy answer is that in general we have those two perspectives of sending, of pushing the services to the data or pushing the data to the services. That has been around for a while, and we already have a big need for that ourselves, because, for instance, the two pilots are very different in that respect. The one that has the satellite data, you don't want to send that anywhere. You have to work on the machines that have the data, because you're not going to send 3 terabytes of data flying through the network all the time. And The other one is you get data, you get smaller data from the data from the sensors. In terms of so again, we're coming a bit to the privacy issue. Do I have to share my data in order to run it because I'm pushing it to the market? No, even if this is a cloud, and as a cloud, you still protect your instance. This is part of the basic core infrastructure as well. It was here first, yes?
Simple and quick question. Are you planning to be in the payment stream as well between various participants?
This is indeed something that we need to discuss in the project, and we've a bit pushed this to the second year. This is why we're going to use open data, and for colleagues who are doing this part of the business models. But essentially, you have to be to some extent because you want to make this sustainable over the next after the next the 3 years. So as a market, you want to take commissions. And then you have to know what is being transferred. Yes. So to some extent, there will be we will be in between. But I'm not sure to what extent. There was another question in the back.
Do you plan to provide a framework for service providers? Kind of framework for publishing the services and having payment issues and payment for the API calls or something?
Yes. Absolutely. So the question was whether we aim to provide a framework for service providers to get payments and to have other things. Because if you build your service, I don't know, you have a new, again, the easiest example, a clustering method or a new application of whatever sort, you would be needing not just that. You would be needing perhaps a Tomcat engine to run your application. To serve the APIs, maybe you need other basic, you know, you need the MongoDB or something running. Essentially, there will be Docker images, and you would combine them. So there is indeed an infrastructure plan that you only need to develop your own service, and you pull the other components from the existing market. Yes.
You evaded the question about the intellectual property. And as a follow-up to the data privacy, how do you make sure that all the data providers and service providers adhere to the GDPR or e-privacy laws, for example? Because if they don't, then I think the data market would disappear quite fast.
The question is, how do we make sure that the data providers behave?
Yeah. So no personal data in the cloud, for example.
Right. This is, I don't have an official answer on behalf of the Data Market Austria. I have a personal answer for that, and my personal answer is we don't. There are law enforcement agencies that would be doing that. We're not going to be the policemen of anything.
Okay.
We can support, but, so, okay, I'll take this as a, what would discourage you from participating in the data market question? And a potential answer would be misbehavior of other players.
Although on the other hand, you're not holding the data.
Not necessarily.
The providers that are holding the data.
But
so, it's providers that would have to, right? So that's the thing.
Yeah.
It's a very fine line to tread. So.
Yes, I agree, but.
That is
point.
But that is something, other platforms also face a very similar problem. Sorry, maybe that's wrong, but on eBay or Billabong, you're not allowed to sell certain things, like, for example, chemical equipment. I'm a chemist from that. That's why that's the reason for this. So you're not allowed to sell that for a good reason. So, and then I believe it is a similar question, right?
Yeah, absolutely. The rules will be there. Enforcement of, the laws will be there. Enforcement of those laws will be done, again, to the extent technologically possible, but we would not have probably somebody paid to go and chase people. But again, that's my answer so far. We've missed the second part from the continued education. So who among you works in a company, not at the university? Okay, so the vast majority are company people. Would you participate in a continued education course on data science? Okay. What would be your expectations from that? One of my concerns about this course would be, why would people participate when they can go online on Coursera and follow it?
What makes it special?
Exactly.
Because somebody actually pushes me to complete it, yeah?
Okay, so that's a very good point. Somebody actually pushes you to complete that. Indeed. My answer to that is as well. The fact that the courses are 30%, half, so 30 credits each module, lecturing, which is indeed something you can do online, and the other half is exercise with your peers in direct, in a face-to-face environment. But other than that, so I've already given you, why would you not participate?
One would expect that the quality of teaching from within every field is high. I mean, in Coursera, one course is a little better, the other one is not. It's rather hard to ask questions on Coursera's very specific questions, which I suppose.
So interacting with the lecturers and consistency of the quality of the lecture.
Networking and doing local projects, because in Coursera, yes, great,
yeah.
Learn there, but it's so generic and you just search a little in Google and you find all the results and new projects, new things connect locally.
Very good point. Networking and new projects. In fact, something that I forgot to do this, if we do this, part of the hours allocated in these exercises are with each company participating. So the company decides on a small project they want to do, and they have the complete decision on what exactly to do. So a number of hours, and I can't remember how many of hours there are, but that's what will be decided by the participating companies.
Good question. So that's the thought is that this is only for companies, it's not for individuals?
Yeah.
The thought it is for companies, yes. Exactly. We have the question?
From my personal experience, one very important point would be to cover this intermediate level between beginner, which is covered vastly on the internet, and expert, which is covered vastly within academia and then publications. And this thing in between, well, how to get from advanced beginner to beginning expert. Something.
Journeyman.
Exactly.
Journeyman. Yeah.
Because as a company, you have employees that already have knowledge in BI, in analytics or whatever, but they have not idea of advanced analytics or data science.
Yeah.
And so you want to educate them to be data scientists.
Okay.
So you have a starting level already.
So in order to complete the know-how within the company to make each individual rounder. But as an individual, you can participate as an Einzelunternehmer, probably.
Perfect.
So there was one more question there, but
it was just a quick statement. If it's aimed at companies, I think it would be important to highlight that there's actually a practical outcome from it. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, personally, what I sometimes fail to understand the help pages of the R functions, and that's because my background of statistics is missing. Yeah. And so, filling that gap is actually an interesting. I don't need to know the academic background of a certain algorithm if I want to use it, but I need to understand what it actually does and why it behaves in a certain way. So, that's sort of that.
Creating the links between the data, the methods, and their applications and their uses.
And the actual research. Yeah.
The actual, okay.
Somewhere in between. Yeah.
I have a general question concerning the curriculum, and there was already one point from behind about knowledge graphs, and my point here is more general. We heard Coursera, we heard MITx or whatever, everybody knows it maybe. Mm-hmm. How do you, what is your plan? How often do you want to update this curriculum? Because this is something where, in my opinion, universities are not really
excelling.
Edge, let's put it like that. the point here is, do we want to hear in 10 years about, I don't know, I don't know, I would doubt it. But maybe there would be a cool lecture about Hadoop then. Well, nice. So, are there any thoughts about that? How to keep the curriculum fresh?
Up to date.
Yes. So exactly. So again, to repeat the question, how do you plan to keep the curriculum fresh? The answer is twofold. One is that this continued education exercise, this particular instance, is unique. If it gets transformed into a program that will be somewhere else, at another university, I mean, at the university as a part of the master's student, for instance, then that question becomes very valid. How do you make sure that people update their content? And in that case, there are two things that one does is you must have the core components, the maths, the statistics, algorithms. You have them and they are forever there. You have to have those. The new technologies that are built on top of those, that those may change. And my opinion is that in order to ensure that, you have to have new lecturers that are familiar.
Could this training also be used to advance some regular study, like technical mathematicians or something else?
Could this training be used
for CET points?
ECTS points. So could this be used as ECTS points in another curricula at any other university?
No.
At the Tovin, for instance. The way I understand it now, no. It is separate. But I may stand corrected on that in the future. But the way I understand it now, no.
How does this platform relate to the Eurostat data? I mean, on the level of the European Union, because they also have such a platform.
The question is, how does this platform relate to the European platform? And I'm not sure what platform we're talking about.
Eurostat, for example.
Eurostat.
Yes.
So we're back to the data market, and how, will we be getting data from Eurostat? To be honest, I have not thought of Eurostat. I mean, Statistic Austria was the one that I would first have as an objective.
Will data be available on the Eurostat, through the Eurostat platform, too?
I would answer no. Also, so will our data be available through the Eurostat platform? First, it's not our data. It's the data provider's data. And I don't think there's the Eurostat does that anyway. So, but maybe there's something I'm missing.
I would like to frame this question maybe a bit more general, because I got the feeling a bit about are there plans to collaborate with other platforms? As you said, there are already some APIs or some providers of good data or open data maybe, but maybe not open data in the sense of, you know, but maybe like Eurostat, who are offering something. I would say the European Central Bank, for example, what I remember, are already also have some platforms. So what is about the European perspective here a bit?
Okay. So the question is, do we plan to integrate with others?
On a European level.
On a European level or otherwise. Yeah. No, so absolutely. Again, we would not, certainly as from the perspective of the data market, of any market, the more players you have, the better you are as a market. So there's no risk, there's no plan on forbidding anybody from participating in the market. Will we actively encourage Eurostat to give us their data? If a broker, perhaps, if somebody decides that there's a good, cool service and we want to build on that, then maybe, yes. Now, how will we participate with other such initiatives? Or are there such initiatives as a data market Austria? Yes, definitely. The, in Germany, there is an industrial data space that has been created, and we are in constant contact with them. And we are agreeing on metadata standards to be used, especially for the data descriptions, that in the future may be allowing us to share data between these two federations. We see the data market itself as eventually a federated state, federated infrastructure, where we would be able to take elements from a different, similar infrastructure. This is really part of the plan, and it answers a number of questions. Particularly, it answers also if you want to have some data but not share it with the others, that essentially says that you're going to build your own data market inside where you have these data components and you can use them, but they're not necessarily public to everybody else. So, yes, but other than the German partners who are doing something very similar, I'm not aware in Europe of something already running. There are initiatives funded by Horizon 2020 that will be starting. And should I wrap up now, perhaps? Unless there are other questions, we can also grab a drink. It's been our two. And I'm going to hang around anyway. So thank you all for your feedback. I look forward to listening to your comments again on the video. I've repeated them all carefully. Thank you.